Good morning. Welcome to worship. Today, during our Lenten journey, we're glad that you have chosen to be here, to be in God's house as we continue this journey leading up to Holy Week. I invite you to take the friendship pads that you'll find in the pew. If you would, sign your name and let us know that you are worshiping with us today. We appreciate any new information that helps us communicate with you, so please add that if there is something new. If you're a guest here this morning, welcome. And if this happens to be your first time here as our guest, we particularly want to welcome you as you get to know our congregation. And I would invite you to stop by our information center right outside this door, and someone will greet you there with some information at the end of the service to help you get to know our congregation. This week, we are continuing our Lenten Musical Wednesdays. This is a series of Wednesday evening special programming where we are highlighting different music opportunities within our church or community. This coming week, on Wednesday, our sanctuary choir and soloists will be sharing their music. 6 o'clock here in our sanctuary. It's preceded by a dinner down in Fellowship Hall, if you'd like to join in that as well. So we hope you'll continue to come to those Wednesday night programs for this week's special sanctuary choir music. In your bulletin, you'll notice a full sheet of information about Holy Week. A lot of worship and programming opportunities. So please note day by day the various things from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday that will be taking place. Mark your calendar and plan to join us for those. And then also in your bulletin is a green insert that talks about Easter flowers. If you'd like to sign up for those so that they can be part of our Easter worship and then take those home with you, please do that today. Today is our deadline, and so we need to have that information back so we can order the flowers in time. So please fill that out and turn that into the office, if you would, please. We've been talking about Financial Peace University now for a number of weeks leading up to a class beginning April 8th. And we thought it might be helpful to hear a personal experience of that. And Mitch Farah is going to share that with us this morning. If you want to step up to the lectern, Mitch.
Good morning. My name is Mitch Farah, and I just am going to talk to you a little bit today about our experience with the Dave Ramsey Financial Peace University program. Dana and I, my wife, kind of came about this by accident. In 2010, my parents gave us Dave Ramsey's program as a Christmas present, unsolicited, and we had no idea who Dave Ramsey was, so that was kind of a strange gift when we opened it. But on the inside cover of the book, my dad had written, I wish when I was your age, somebody would have told me about this. Which that struck me a little bit, so it gave the program a little bit of credibility for us to even start. So we listened to the CDs, we did the workbook, we read the book, and we've had some success with it. Two things that I think that have been helpful with the program is it really framed a financial discussion between Dana and I, which we hadn't had before, and it was a successful program for us. We were able to go debt-free, except for our mortgage, in a relatively short period of time, and to stay that way. The program also frames your money and your finances and your budget in a Christian perspective, which I think is a different perspective than most financial people out there give you. You should be prepared for a few things. There's some envelopes, and this is a cash program. So 4 years ago, we went cash, stopped using our credit card and our debit card. So we would go to the bank every week to get our money in cash and put it in envelopes. So the tellers at the bank would look at us and, what are you doing? Are you going on a trip? Are you buying something? Nope, just getting our budget. Well, you know if you use your credit card or your debit card, you get rewards points and you can get free stuff. We'll just take the money, please. So we took the money, and now 4 years later, when we go into the bank, they know us by name, And they tell us, boy, a lot of people are doing this now. More people are coming in and getting cash from the bank instead of using their credit. I don't know if it's Dave Ramsey or if it's the hacking things that are going on, but people seem to be going away from credit, at least at our bank. So if you're on the edge trying to decide if you want to get into this or you think it's going to be a good plan, from one person's perspective, it works, and I would highly recommend it. It's not a quick fix. It's not a magic pill. It takes self-discipline, some control, self-control, patience. It's somewhat like being a Christian, I guess. Thanks.
Thank you, Mitch. It's always good to have that personal perspective. There is a cap on the class, and so if you're interested, please sign up right away so that we can make sure you get into the class as it's offered this time. I invite you now to stand and to greet one another today with a warm welcome.
Please join me in the responsive invocation. Word of God, come down on earth, living rain from heaven descending. Touch our hearts and bring to birth faith and hope and love unending. Word Almighty, we revere you. Word made flesh, we long to hear. Word eternal, thrown down high. Word that brought to life creation. Word that came from heaven to die, crucified for our salvation. Saving world, speak to us. Word that speaks your Father's love, one with God beyond all telling. Word that sends us from above, God the Spirit with us dwelling. Word of truth to all who need us. Word of life with one heart.
Thank you.
children here this morning. Oh, I see one head popping up. Come on up for a special time with Diane today.
Good morning, Gage. Happy spring. You look like spring today. Did you get to play outside yesterday, Fanny? Great. I was out in the yard poking around, and guess what I saw? Peeking through some sheltering leaves, I saw tulips. Now, I look at those beautiful ones. Mine are only an inch high, but I know there's a promise. They're gifts from God, our Creator, and they made me smile. Do you like presents? Do you like to receive presents? Do you like to give presents? Something you like that you're giving to someone you might like for yourself, and you think, is it kind of hard to get? I'd like to keep it for myself. Did that ever happen? We're going to open our treasure box today. You're going to have a job. This is a glass that has water in it, so I'm going to have you hold it. And I want to tell you about a special gift. The more you give, the more you have to keep. And do you know what that gift is? Something you can give away, and you can keep it. And it's not water. But the water in there is going to represent love. And we're going to start. You're going to have to do all the work today. I wasn't waiting. These are some glass beads, and I'd like you to put one in the water. Just pop it through the hole. And that's you. You're surrounded by love, and there's lots of love. Who else loves you? God does. Please put a big one in for God. I have to pop. Give it a push. Mom and Dad? Oh, you might need two more. And I know who's out there that loves you a lot. Grandma and Grandpa. Better put two in for them. And your brother. Oh, boy, the water's going up. Do you have some cousins or aunts and uncles? Oh, he's putting a lot in now.
I have a lot of cousins.
Lots of cousins, okay. That's okay. That might be a half cousin or something. Right. And friends at school and at home and in our church family. And you have lots out there. Boy, you could empty that bag because I see a lot of friendly faces out there. And do you know what's happening to that water? Oh, he's going to do it the fast way. Thank you. What happened to our water?
It rose.
It rose. It went up. Was any of the water used up? No. It grows and grows. Let's thank God for the gift of love. It never, ever runs out. And our scripture today is Ephesians 3:17b-19. I pray that your life will be strong in love and be built in love. And I pray that you and all God's holy people will have the power to understand the greatness of Christ's love. I pray that you can understand how wide and how long and how high and how deep that love is. Christ's love is greater than any person can ever know. But I pray that you will be able to know that love. Then you can be filled with the fullness of God. Will you join me in prayer, please? Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for all your continuing love, for your Son Jesus, who you gave to us to set that example of love for others. Please be with us as we go through Lent and we study about your Son, and we appreciate all that he did and gave. We ask in your name, amen. I have a pretend glass with water and some marbles that are in layers that you can fill your glass and think of all the people that love you. And if you would like the glass of water, you can take that too, because you're my only friend today. I mean, you're not my only friend, but you're the only person that came up. Thank you. Have a good spring day.
Thank you, Diane and Gage, for that lesson today. As we come to our time of offering, a reminder that as we continue through March now, we are designating our loose coin offering for our Lithuania mission trip coming up this summer. So we thank you for your loose change that you put in the offering plate that will go directly to that, as well as any designated gifts that you'd like to share. We appreciate that. We also thank you for your tithes and offering that you bring with you, returning to God a portion of what God has abundantly blessed you with. Our ushers will now collect that offering.
Please join me in the responsive prayer of dedication. God, whose giving knows no ending, from your rich and endless store, nature's wonder, Jesus' wisdom, costly cross, grave's shattered door, gifted by you, we turn to you, offering up ourselves in praise. Thankful song shall rise forever, gracious donor of our days. Treasure, too, you have entrusted, gained through powers your grace conferred, ours to use for home and kindred, and to spread the gospel's word. Open wide our hands in sharing, as we heed Christ's ageless call, healing, teaching, and reclaiming, serving you by loving all.
we come to our time of prayer today, a reminder of the folks who have listed, who have been listed in your bulletin. That list continues to grow, continues to change. Invite you to pray for Jerry Potts. Jerry is hospitalized in Milwaukee with serious health concerns. Prayers for Jerry during this time, and as well as his family. Also for Chris Hartnick, who is the nurse at our pantry, and you often see her sitting in the office selling scrip on Sunday morning. She has had some surgery and is now needing rehab, so we pray for her during this time as well. And others on your list, we pray for them. Let us join now in our prayer chorus. Today on this fifth Sunday of Lent, worshiping you along with other fellow Christ followers. We come to you today in the name of Jesus Christ, the living Word. We thank you today for salvation through his sacrificial death on the cross on our behalf. We've been set free from the power and bondage of sin and given new life in Christ. We therefore have the privilege of walking with you day by day. Each day is new and different. Each day is a new experience as we walk with you. We've never walked this way before, so we need you as a guide. We thank you for the gentle voice and promptings of the Holy Spirit that keep us in the right way and enables us to avoid the pitfalls and difficulties that come along the way. You're always there, even when we're unaware of your presence, and we thank you. Father God, we thank you, too, that you have a plan and a purpose for each of us. We know you know all about our abilities as well as our limitations. You know about our personalities and our character, and your plan and leading is exactly right for us. And as we understand and try to follow your will and your way, we can rest assured that you always desire the best, so we can leave the choice to you. You don't make mistakes, and you don't need to rethink things. We sometimes misunderstand and fail to get it right, but you never do. Thank you, Lord, for being who and what you are. You're trustworthy, unchanging, and we can be secure in your everlasting love. Loving God, I pray that you would look down inside each of us and see all the needs that are there, see the frustrations and disappointments, see the failures and even the sins that might be there. We know that you can do something about them. We're looking to you right now to meet those needs and bring healing and restoration and forgiveness. Please be with those who are dealing with illness and physical problems, with those newly diagnosed and those dealing with chronic issues, and with those nearing the end of their life's journey. You designed our bodies and you understand how they're supposed to work. We pray that even right now, in this service, you would bring healing and wholeness to those who need your physical touch. There may even be some who don't know that they have a sickness or disease, but you know about it already, and we would ask you for healing even before they know they have a need. You can do that, Lord, and that's what we're asking. Almighty God, we pray for the conflicts going on in our world between evil and good, between wickedness and godliness. We pray for your kingdom to come and for human hearts to be turned to you. We pray for the military who are involved in areas of crisis. May they call upon you for protection and for your intervention in the life and death struggles they face. We pray for the leaders of our state and nation. Give them wisdom and understanding, and may they call upon you for guidance and direction. How we need a turning to you and to the principles of righteousness and holiness and godliness revealed in your word. Allow things to come that will turn hearts to you, O Lord. We thank you for walking with us on our Lenten journey. We thank you for Jesus, your living word, and for his spirit. And we pray that this all now in the powerful name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Scripture reading is from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 9. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes through the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I spent this past week in Kentucky, attending a continuing education event for clergy down at a seminary down there. I left on Monday morning and got back into town last evening. The last thing I did before leaving town on Monday was drop off my girls at school. I drop them off at school every morning, and every morning when I drop them off at school, I give them a hug and a kiss. On Monday, I gave them longer hugs because I was conscious of the fact that I wasn't going to see them all week. And because I hate being separated from my children. Separation, you know, runs contrary to the instincts of love, because love desires togetherness. And so we human beings often have a hard time saying goodbye to people we love, because love doesn't want to be apart. Love wants to be together. Since all of us know the experience of having to say goodbye to a loved one who is leaving for a time and how difficult that is, imagine with me this extra layer of difficulty. If, when you're saying goodbye, you don't know where that loved one is going, and you don't know when they'll be back. Because that was the scene around the table at the Last Supper. All four gospel writers tell us about the Last Supper, but John tells us more about the Last Supper than anyone else. He gives us more detail. John's account of the Last Supper is not only longer than what we find in Matthew or Mark or Luke. John's account is longer than Matthew's and Mark's and Luke's combined. John's gospel has 21 chapters. Five of those 21 chapters are spent around that table, which suggests that in John's understanding, this event was one of the most important events in Jesus' life and ministry. So, John gives us an extended glimpse into that table, and he records for us a lot of the dialogue that took place between Jesus and his disciples. And during that conversation, Jesus makes several references to the fact that he is going away. Well, that prospect is naturally a sad one for the disciples, the prospect of Jesus going away. And then it's further complicated by this, that they don't seem to know where he's going, and they have no idea when they'll see him again. Jesus, on the other hand, knows exactly where he is going. And as we listen to how he talks about where he's going, we discover that it is not only fascinating, it is exemplary. The Last Supper occurs, you know, on Thursday night. And Jesus understands fully that in just a few hours, there will be this chain of events about to start. He'll be arrested, he'll be tried, he'll be tortured, and he'll be put to death. And yet when Jesus on Thursday night talks about where he's going, he doesn't talk about going to trial. He doesn't talk about going to the cross. He doesn't talk about going to the tomb. Instead, as he talks about where he's going, he seems to be looking past all of that. The writer of Hebrews says, "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross." And so as we hear Jesus' words on Thursday night, we sense that he's looking past Friday. He's looking past Friday to the joy that is set before him. What joy is that? Well, this is where we meet the second exemplary feature of how Jesus talks about where he's going. Because he doesn't talk about it in terms of a place. We know from what Jesus says and from other passages of Scripture that he eventually ascends to heaven. But he doesn't really talk here about going to heaven because he doesn't speak in terms of place. He speaks in terms of person, in terms of relationship. When he says where he says he's going to the Father. Doesn't say he's going to heaven. He says he's going to the Father. It's not about place. It's about person. It's beautiful. We know how that is because we do a certain amount of that, you know. There are certain travel plans we have where we don't perhaps ever mention the town where we're going because we identify our destination in terms of people. I'm going to spend Thanksgiving with my mother. We're going to see our son at college. We're leaving town to visit our new grandchild, see. We identify people as our destination. This is what Jesus is doing. It's lovely. It's personal. When he talks about where he's going, he really talks about to whom he is going. He's going to the Father. So here is this beautiful scene. The cross is looming before him, and he knows it. But he is not in the least preoccupied with the prospect of pain or death. Instead, on the very eve of his passion, he is focused on his Father. He is going to his Father. Evidently, the disciples don't understand that at all at the moment, which brings us then to the passage that Sidney shared with us a moment ago. Jesus says to them, "You know where I'm going, and you know the way to get there." And Thomas then does everybody a favor by being the one to, you know, pipe up and say the candid thing. He says, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" To which Jesus responds, "I am the way." So it turns out they did know the way. Even if they didn't know where he was going, they knew the way because they knew him. And he says that he is the way. We have, you know, both in Scripture and in theology, we have a lot of lofty language, elegant terms that we use to try to describe God. But here, when Jesus finds a term to describe himself, it is not glamorous or lofty. It is a common, everyday word that refers to a common, everyday thing. We traditionally translate it way, "I am the way." But that same underlying Greek word gets translated in the New Testament as road, path, highway. Jesus is saying, "I am the road. I am the highway that you take from here to there." So, how do you get to Milwaukee? Well, you take Highway 43. How do you get to Oshkosh? Well, you take Highway 41. How do you get to Shawnee? Take Highway 29. And how do you get to God? How do you get to the Father? You take Jesus, for he is the way. Our family lived for a time in a town that literally had a bridge to nowhere. It was constructed to go across a highway. It was a new kind of bypass that had been built around town. And it ran along the southern edge of the town. And this bridge that they built went over the highway so you could get easily to the other side. The expectation was that that property on the other side was ripe for residential development and growth. But shortly after the bridge was constructed, the housing market took its hit in 2008, and that residential development never materialized. So you can go there today and see this very handsome bridge, you know, still looks like new, But there are all kinds of impediments in the way to keep people from driving on it. Structurally, it'll support traffic, and logistically, it'll get you to the other side. But practically, it won't do you any good, because the bridge ends abruptly in a cornfield on the other side of the highway. So many ways, so many roads and paths that a person might take, only to discover that they don't get you where you want to go. They don't get us where we need to be. So right after Jesus says he is the way, he follows that with another term, truth. I am the way and the truth. And those two things go naturally together, you see. Because you have to know the truth if you're going to find the way, right? If every road sign and every direction given in life was accurate, reliable, trustworthy, correct, then I suppose we'd be fine. But imagine this. Imagine that you're driving along and you need to stop and ask someone for directions. That's something we do less and less now with our technology. But you remember what that's like, to have to stop and ask somebody for directions. And imagine the person you ask doesn't actually know the way to where you need to go, but he gives you directions anyway. It's a problem. Or imagine that GPS in your car or on your phone somehow malfunctions. It keeps telling you to turn left and right and go 2 miles and what have you, but it's out of sync, and it's inaccurate. If every road sign and every direction given in life is accurate and reliable and trustworthy and correct, then we're fine. But if the sources around us are not reliable, then we need to know the truth for ourselves. Then we need to know personally the way. And the sources around us are not reliable. For centuries, Christian theologians have referred to the world, the flesh, and the devil as the three great enemies of the soul. The world, the flesh, and the devil. And I think you and I know from Scripture and from our own experience that all those things are inclined to mislead us. The world, the flesh, and the devil. My flesh routinely points me in the wrong direction. The world is all kinds of misguided. And from the Garden of Eden on, the devil has been trying to mislead us, you know, pointing one way when we're supposed to go the other way, making evil look good. So we need to know the truth in order to find the way. And Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. And then he adds another word, life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Which is a natural companion to the previous two because it speaks to our destination, you know. The writer of Proverbs says a sobering thing. He says there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death. Seems right, but it leads to death. So unlike that useless, harmless bridge that we used to live near, he's saying that if you choose the wrong road in life, it doesn't just end up in a cornfield. It ends up in death. So, with so much at stake, and with so many paths and options, and with so much misguidance around us and within us, what's a person to do? The answer is simple, profound, and beautiful. Jesus says, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. Interestingly, all three of those concepts, way, truth, life, they're all associated elsewhere in Scripture with the Word of God. So, for example, the psalmist and Isaiah both talk about God's Word as a path, the way in which we should walk. The psalmist and Jesus both refer to God's Word as truth. Moses, Peter, James, John, they all refer to the Word of God and associate it with life, see? Way, truth, and life. Then Jesus comes as the incarnate Word of God, remember? the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. And then he added one more word. He said, no one comes to the Father but by me. No one comes to the Father but by Jesus. That's a passage a lot of folks choke on, you know. In a pluralistic culture, in a relativistic intellectual environment, this particular teaching of Jesus is offensive to a lot of folks because it seems exclusive, because it sounds like it leaves a lot of people out. I want to say to you this morning, there's a great difference between exclusive and singular. Jesus is singular, but he's not at all exclusive. Now think of it this way. Here's a building that could have 15 different entrances, and they could all say restricted, authorized personnel only, you know. So there are all kinds of entrances, but I can't get in any of them because it's exclusive. On the other hand, there could be a public park with only one entrance, but anybody can go there. Jesus is singular, but he's not at all exclusive. For God so loved the world, you see, that whosoever, fill in the blank, whosoever believeth in him, whoever comes to me, Jesus says, I will by no means turn away. Make disciples of all nations, he says. So he says he is the only way, but that way is open to everybody, every color and nationality, rich, poor, sick, healthy, Jew, Gentile, respectable, despicable, exclusive is the last thing Jesus is. We, humanity, we were trapped in sin and in death, and we longed for God. But the sign said you can't get there from here. And we can't. By ourselves, we can't. We can't get there from here. Not by our wits, not by our deeds, not by our philosophies, not by our scores of invented religions. We cannot get there from here by ourselves. We're trapped in sin and death like a room that's got no doors or windows, and then God opens a door. He shows us a way, the way, cuts through all the deception and misguidedness and shows us the truth, breaks the cycle and grip of death, offers us life. It is free, it is full of love, and it is for everyone. And it is Jesus. So Charles Wesley sings, the veil is rent in Christ alone. The living way to heaven is seen. The middle wall is broken down. And all the world may enter in. Our loving Heavenly Father, you see, hates to be separated from his children. And so he provided a way for him to come to us and for us to come to him. To get to a physical place, you take a physical road. It shouldn't surprise us, therefore, that to get to a person, you take a person. And specifically for a human being to get to God, you take the person who is both man and God. Jesus is the way to the Father. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for providing a way and showing us the way, a wide open invitation that requires no merit on our part, no price of admission, no test to pass, extended in grace and in love, and asking only for our response, our believing response. We thank you for Jesus. And we ask that you would help us to see him and this world that you love clearly enough that we might point them to the way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We understand to be your will, Father, that we should know your Son so that he might lead us to you, and that the world for which he came and for which he died might know him as well. It is our privilege, our eternal privilege, to know him and to share him. So we thank you. As we leave this place into that world for Christ's sake. Amen.
Good morning. The sanctuary choir and organ have prepared us for worship today. It is time now. So we're glad that you are here to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ together as we come to this day, to this place for worship. I want to invite you to take the friendship pads that you'll find in the pew. If you would, sign your name. Let us know that you are worshiping with us here today. If you have new information, we always appreciate that so that we can help communicate with you. If you're a guest here this morning, welcome. And if you are here as our first-time guest, we particularly want to welcome you. And invite you at the end of the service to stop by our welcome center, our information center right outside this door. Someone will greet you there with some items to help you remember this first visit to First Church. And then as you continue with us on our Lenten journey, hopefully, we look forward to getting to know you. And welcome back to some of our snowbirds who have been away for a number of weeks and months. And it's good to have you back, beginning to see some of the snowbirds coming back to our flock, our congregation, and we're glad for that. During Lent, on Wednesday evenings, we are having various musical opportunities in part of our programming, and we have had a number of great things along the way. This Wednesday night, our sanctuary choir and some soloists will be sharing their music with us. 6 o'clock here in the sanctuary. We look forward to that time. They've been preparing and have some great music in store for us. There is a supper prior to that at 5:15 in Fellowship Hall, so if you'd like to join us for that, and then the musical program, we'd love to have you. There is in your bulletin a whole page of the Holy Week schedule, from Palm Sunday through Easter Sunday, and all the different worship services and programming opportunities during those days. So please note that schedule and plan to put it into your thinking and your calendar. We look forward to that. There is a green insert in your bulletin related to Easter flowers. That if you'd like to support that or buy some flowers to have as part of our Easter floral decoration here in the sanctuary, and then take those home with you. Please fill that out and turn that in today. Today is the deadline. We need to know that so we can get those on order and have those ready for Easter Sunday. Coming up on April 8th is our Financial Peace University. We've been talking about it now for a number of weeks. We're looking forward to that. The class is filling. But we thought we might give you a first-hand experience with it that someone might share with you. So Mitch Farah is here to do that for us today. Mitch?
Morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mitch Farah, and I'm here to talk to you a little bit about Dave Ramsey's program. Dana and I were reluctant participants in Dave Ramsey's program. We received this as a Christmas gift from my parents back in 2010. I didn't take it personally. My brother and sister got it too, so it wasn't an indictment of my financial prowess. But what I will tell you is that it's been very successful for us. And the reason that we really started it was on the inside cover of the book that my dad had given us. He wrote, "I wish when I was your age, someone had told me about this." So I took that to heart. I respect my dad, so we got into the program and have done it. So two perspectives or positives that it helped us with in our family was that it really opened the communication between Dana, my wife, and I about finances. Where do we want to be? How do we want to get there? Sometimes those can be difficult conversations. Secondly, it really framed our budget, our money, our income, our expenses in a Christian perspective, which was something that was pretty new for us, I would say, and it has been very helpful. So the experiences that we've had, we were able to pay off all of our debt, except for our mortgage, in a relatively short period of time, been able to keep that off. So that's been a positive. And second, another experience that we've had that was a bit strange at first. Part of the program is you use cash instead of your credit or your debit card. So we would go to the bank every 2 weeks to get cash for our two-week budget. When we first started going, the tellers would try and remind us, you know, you get rewards points for using credit cards, right? You know you get free stuff if you use our credit cards. Well, after 4 years, they know us by name at the bank, for sure. But now they're telling us how other people are getting cash. More people are doing what we've been doing for the past 4 years. So I'm not sure exactly where that shift has come from, but that's been an experience that we've had. So you might want to, you may get to know your banker better if you do this program. So for one person's perspective and one family's perspective, I would recommend the Dave Ramsey program. It's not a magic bullet, it's not a quick fix. It takes some self-control, takes some dedication, patience, perseverance. It's kind of a lot like being a Christian. So hopefully you give it some consideration, and if you're on the edge, I would recommend it. Thank you.
The Financial Peace University class does have a cap as to the number of participants, so if you're at all interested, please sign up today or very soon so that you can get in and be part of that very worthwhile experience. In a few minutes in the service, we're going to have a baptism, and as our practice here, we share a witness to the baptism. That's a certificate that we pass around during the service, so when you receive that, please sign your name. And that will let the family know that you were part of this service and witnessed the baptism of their child. I invite you now to stand and to greet one another today with a warm welcome.
Join me in the responsive invocation. Word of God, come down on earth, living rain from heaven descending. Touch our hearts and bring to birth faith and hope and love unending. Word Almighty, we revere you. Word made flesh, we long to hear you. Word eternal, throned on high. Word that brought to life creation. Word that came from heaven to die, crucified for our salvation. Saving word, the world restoring, speak to us, your love outpouring. Word that speaks your Father's love, one with God beyond all telling. Word that sends us from above, God the Spirit, with us dwelling. Word of truth, to all truth lead us. Word of life, with one bread feed us.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. It's a great hymn. I loved it 15 minutes ago. I love it more now. I should say, I actually fell in love with that hymn in this church, because my first recollection of ever singing it or hearing it sung was a time when my family came back here and I was 14 years old. And we sang that hymn in the sanctuary. I was sitting back around where Scott and Bridget are right now. And I remember being captivated by the hymn. And so it's sentimental for me to sing it here with you now. It's our privilege to celebrate together this morning as a church family the sacrament of baptism. So you have the certificates that are working their way through the sanctuary, and you're putting your name on them. As you do, I invite you to ponder how you might also make your mark on this child's life. Because that's a part of what we're pledging ourselves to when we take our vows as a congregation at the baptism of a child. We are volunteering, more than that, we're committing ourselves to being instruments of God in the lives of the child, in the life of the child. So, you know, I grew up in the church, all kinds of people who have no idea what an influence they were on me, what a blessing they were to me in the churches where I grew up. And that may be you, and only God knows. But we are committing ourselves to that. So with that good privilege before us, let me invite the family to come forward for the baptism. Three questions for you, and we've talked about them, significant questions. First of all, this, do you this day confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Second, do you accept the teachings of the Holy Scriptures as your rule of faith and conduct? And then, will you, as much as in you lies, seek to raise this child in the Christian faith, nurturing her by both your instruction and your example?
We will.
And my questions are addressed to the congregation gathered here today. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm your commitment to Christ? If so, will you answer, we do?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include these persons now before you in your care? And your response is in your bulletin. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Delora with a community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her, that she may be a true disciple, walking in the way that leads to life.
Let's pray together. Father, when we think of the scenes in our mind's eye, the scenes of the ministry of Jesus, we see so often the evidence of his love for children, even encouraging the adults around them to become like children. We picture especially him holding the children on his knee, laying his hands on them, blessing them. And we believe in this moment of baptism that you hold this little girl and you bless her because you love her. We pray your blessing on her parents, on her family and friends, that they would be supported and surrounded and upheld by your love. We thank you, too, for the sacraments with which you do your mysterious and potent work in our lives, including just now the water of baptism.
Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and her who receives it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, Elora may share in Christ's final victory. Amen.
have to get a little closer. What name do you give to this child?
Alora Ann Correll.
Okay. Alora Ann Correll. I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Okay, we're all going to pray for you now. Let's gather around and lay hands on her.
The Holy Spirit work within you, Elora, that being born through the water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Annie and Jeff. Appreciate your music today. This month, our loose coin offering is going to support our Lithuania mission trip this summer, where our 10 students and 5 adults are going to our sister church in Pilviškė, Lithuania. And we are supporting them in one way through our loose coin offering. So any change that you put in the offering plate, as well as any designated gifts, will go directly to that mission this summer, and we thank you for that. We also thank you for the offering that you bring as part of your worship experience, returning to God a portion of what God has abundantly blessed you with. Our ushers will now collect that offering.
Please join me in the responsive prayer of dedication. God, whose giving knows no ending, from your rich and endless store, nature's wonder, Jesus' wisdom, costly cross, grave's shattered door. Gifted by you, we turn to you, offering up ourselves in praise. Thankful song shall rise forever, gracious donor of our days. Treasure too, you have entrusted, gained through powers your grace conferred, ours to use for home and kindred, and to spread the gospel word. Open wide our hands in sharing as we heed Christ's ageless call, healing, teaching, and reclaiming, serving you by loving all.
Thank you.
be seated. The scriptures remind us to pray for one another, and so each week we list in the bulletin folks who have asked for prayer, and we invite you to take that list and pray over those names during your week, during your personal prayer time. Just an update, Jerry Potts is in the hospital in Milwaukee with some serious health concerns. And Chris Hartnick, who is the nurse at our pantry, and you see her Sunday morning often in the office selling our script. She had surgery this week and is needing rehab now, and we pray for Chris in that, as well as all the others on our list today. Let us join in the prayer chorus. So good to be here today on this fifth Sunday of Lent, worshiping you along with other Christ followers. We come to you today in the name of Jesus Christ, the living Word. We thank you today for salvation through his sacrificial death on the cross on our behalf. We've been set free from the power and bondage of sin and given new life in Christ. We therefore have the privilege of walking with you day by day. Each day is a new and different experience. We've never walked this way before, so we need you as our guide. We thank you for the gentle voice and promptings of the Holy Spirit that keeps us in the right way, enables us to avoid the pitfalls and difficulties that come along the way. You're always there, even when we're unaware of your presence, and so we thank you. Father God, we thank you, too, that you have a plan and purpose for each of us. You know all about our abilities as well as our limitations. You know about our personalities and our character, and your plan and leading is exactly right for us. And as we understand and try to follow your will and your way, we can rest assured that you always desire the best. So we can leave the choice to you. You don't make mistakes, and you don't need to rethink things. We sometimes misunderstand and fail to get it right. You never do. Thank you, Lord, for being who and what you are. You're trustworthy, unchanging, and we can be secure in your everlasting love. Loving God, I pray that you would look down inside each of us and see all the needs that are there. See the frustrations and disappointments. See the failures and even the sins that might be there. We know that you can do something about them. We're looking to you right now to meet those needs and bring healing and restoration and forgiveness. Please be with those who are dealing with illness and physical problems, with those newly diagnosed and those dealing with chronic issues, and those nearing the end of their journey with us. You designed our bodies and you understand how they're supposed to work. We pray that even right now in this service, you might bring healing and wholeness to those who need your physical touch. There are even some who don't know that they have a sickness or disease, but you know that about it already, and we would ask you for healing even before they know they need it. You can do that, Lord. And that's what we're asking. Almighty God, we pray for the conflicts going on in our world between evil and good, between wickedness and godliness. We pray for your kingdom to come and for human hearts to be turned to you. We pray for the military who are involved in areas of crisis. May they call upon you for protection and for your intervention in the life and death struggles they face. We pray for the leaders of our state and nation. Give them wisdom and understanding, and may they call upon you for guidance and direction. How we need a turning to you and to the principles of righteousness and holiness and godliness revealed in your word. Allow things to come that will turn hearts to you, Lord. We thank you for walking with us on our Lenten journey. We thank you for Jesus, your living word, and for his Spirit. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture reading is from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 9. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I spent this past week in Kentucky attending a continuing education event for clergy sponsored by a seminary down there. I left on Monday morning and got back late last night. The last thing I did before leaving town on Monday was drop my girls off at school. I drop them off every morning at school, every school day morning. And every morning that I drop them off, I give them a hug and a kiss when I say goodbye. But this past Monday, I found myself giving each one of them a longer hug because I was conscious of the fact that I wouldn't see them all week. And because I hate being separated from my children. Separation, you know, runs contrary to the instincts of love. Because love desires togetherness. You know? So we human beings often find it hard to say goodbye to someone we love because love wants to be together. Love doesn't want to be apart. Since we all know what it feels like to have to say goodbye to some loved one who is leaving, then let me ask you to imagine the extra difficulty. If you don't know where the loved one is going, and if you don't know when they'll be back, because that was the scene around the table at the Last Supper. All four Gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all four Gospel writers tell us about the Last Supper. But John tells us more about it than any of the other three. John's account is not just longer than Matthew's account or Mark's account or Luke's account. John's account of the Last Supper is longer than all three of the other Gospels put together, their accounts of the Last Supper, that is. John's Gospel is 21 chapters long, and five of those 21 chapters are spent at that table, at the Last Supper. Five out of 21 chapters in his Gospel, which suggests that in John's understanding, this was one of the most important events in Jesus' life and ministry. So, with all that time, all that space devoted to telling this story, John gives us a lot of details about the dialogue that took place there at that table. And in the midst of that conversation that Jesus had with his disciples, he makes reference several times to the fact that he's going away. That prospect is naturally a sad one for the disciples, the prospect of Jesus going away. And then it has this added complication to it, and namely, that they don't know where he's going, and they don't know when they'll see him again. Jesus, on the other hand, knows exactly where he's going. And as we hear him talk about where he's going, we find it's not just interesting, It's exemplary. The Last Supper, you remember, takes place on Thursday night. Jesus knows full well, while he's talking to his disciples, that in just a few hours there is a chain of events that's going to begin. He knows he's about to be arrested and tried and tortured and put to death. And yet, when he's at the table with them and talking about where he's going, he doesn't talk about going to trial or about going to the cross or about going to the grave. Instead, he seems to look past all of that and focuses on what comes after that. The writer of Hebrews says, "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross." So as we hear him talking around the table on that Thursday night, we sense in his words that he's looking beyond Friday. He's looking beyond to the joy that's set before him. And what is that joy? Well, that is the second remarkable and exemplary thing about how he talks about where he's going. Because he doesn't talk in terms of place. We know from what Jesus says and from other passages of Scripture that he eventually ascends to heaven. But he doesn't talk about going to heaven. Because he doesn't talk about where he's going in terms of place, but in terms of person, in terms of a relationship. He says he's going to the Father. He's going to heaven, but he doesn't say he's going to heaven. He says he's going to the Father. Not about place, but about person. We know how that works because we do some of that ourselves. There are certain travel plans that when we talk about them, we won't necessarily mention the town that we're going to because we identify people as our destination. So we'll say things like, I'm going to spend Thanksgiving with my mother, or we're heading off to visit our son at college, or we're leaving town to see our new grandchild. See, we're not really talking about place. We identify persons as our destination. And that is the lovely thing Jesus is doing here. Where is he going? He's going to his Father. And here he is, just hours removed from the cross, yet he's not focused on the prospect of pain or death. Instead, on the very eve of his passion, he's focused on going to his Father. He's going to his Father. Well, the disciples don't know that at first. They don't understand that. Which brings us then to the passage that Mary just shared with us, that excerpt from the large Last Supper scene we have in John's Gospel. Jesus says to them, "You know where I'm going, and you know the way to get there." And then Thomas is very helpful because he pipes up and says what probably all the rest of them are thinking. He says, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus replies to that, "I am the way." So it turns out they did know the way after all. Even though they might not have known where he was going, they knew the way because they knew him. And he said that he is the way. We have, you know, in Scripture and certainly in theology, a lot of terminology, elegant, lofty terminology that we use to try to describe God. But here, when Jesus describes himself, the word he uses is not at all lofty or elegant. Instead, he uses a common, everyday word that refers to an exceedingly common and everyday thing. We traditionally translate it way, I am the way, but the same underlying Greek word is also translated in the New Testament as road, and path, and highway. Jesus is saying, I'm the road. I'm the highway that gets you from here to there. So, how do you get to Milwaukee? Well, you take Highway 43. How do you get to Oshkosh? Well, you take Highway 41. How do you get to Shawnee? You take Highway 29. And how do you get to God? How do you get to the Father? You take Jesus. For he is the way. Our family lived for a number of years in a town that literally had a bridge to nowhere. It was built across a highway, a highway that was kind of a bypass along the southern edge of the town. And this bridge was built across the highway for convenience in anticipation of the residential development that was expected to grow up on the other side of the highway. Except that shortly after the bridge was built, the housing market was hit by the events of 2008, and that housing development never materialized. So you can go there today and see this very handsome bridge, you know, looks like new. But there are impediments in the way to keep people from driving on it. Structurally, it can handle traffic, and logistically, it'll get you across the highway. But practically, it'll do you no good, because it just ends abruptly in the middle of a cornfield on the other side. So many ways, so many roads that a person might take only to find that it doesn't get you where you want to go. Doesn't get us where we need to be. So it is that right after saying he's the way, he adds this other term that goes naturally with it. He says, I am the way and I am the truth. And the way and the truth go together, you see, because if you don't know the truth, you'll never find the right way, right? I suppose that if every road sign, every direction given in life is accurate, trustworthy, reliable, correct, then we're fine. But imagine that it's not. Imagine that you're driving along in a place you don't know and you have to stop and ask someone for directions. We don't do much of that anymore with all of our technology, but you remember what that's like to have to stop and ask a person for directions. Imagine you stop and ask a person, and that person doesn't actually know how to get to where you need to go, but they give you directions anyway. Or you're relying on the GPS in your phone or in your car, and it malfunctions, but you don't know it. And it's still telling you to turn left and right and go 1,000 feet and go 2.5 miles, but it's out of sync, and it's not accurate anymore. If all the road signs and all the directions given in life are accurate and trustworthy and reliable and correct, then we're fine. But if the sources around us are not reliable, then we need to know the truth for ourselves. We need to know the way. And the sources around us are not reliable. For centuries, you know, Christian theologians have referred to three things: the world, the flesh, and the devil, as the great enemies of the soul. The world, the flesh, and the devil. I expect that all of us know, both from Scripture and from our own experience, how each of those things is inclined to mislead us. The world, the flesh, and the devil. My flesh routinely points me in wrong directions. The world is all kinds of misguided. And ever since the Garden of Eden, the devil has been trying to deceive us, pointing one way when we're supposed to go the other way, making evil look like it's good. So we need to know the truth in order to find the way. And Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. And then he adds another word, life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. That's a natural companion to the first two because it speaks to our destination. The writer of Proverbs says along the way, pretty sober thing. He says, there is a way that seems right to a person, but in the end it leads to death. So in contrast to that useless but harmless bridge that I used to live near, the writer of Proverbs is saying, if you take the wrong way in life, it doesn't just land you in a cornfield. It leads to death. So with so much at stake, and with so many paths, and so much misguidedness both around us and within, what's a person to do? The answer is simple, profound, and lovely. Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. Way, truth, and life. Interestingly, you know, all three of those concepts are associated elsewhere in Scripture with God's Word. Both Isaiah and the psalmist talk about God's Word being like a path, like a way, the way that we're supposed to travel. Jesus and the psalmist both call God's Word truth. Moses, Peter, Paul, John, all associate God's word with life. And then Jesus comes as God's incarnate word. Remember? The word became flesh and dwelt among us and said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And then he added one more thing. No one comes to the Father but by me. No one comes to the Father except by Jesus. That's a passage that a lot of folks choke on. In our pluralistic culture, in our relativistic intellectual environment, a lot of people take offense at this particular teaching of Jesus because it sounds exclusive. Sounds like it leaves a lot of people out. But I want to say to you this morning that there's a great difference between exclusive and singular. Jesus is singular, but he's not at all exclusive. Think of it this way. There might be a building that has 15 different entrances to it, and they might all say, you know, authorized personnel only. So it has 15 entrances, but I can't go in any of them because it's exclusive. On the other hand, there may be a public park that has just one entrance to it, but anyone can go there. Jesus is singular, but he is not at all exclusive. For God so loved the world, after all, that whosoever, fill in the blank, whosoever believeth in him. He says, whoever comes to me, I will by no means turn away. Make disciples of all nations. Jesus says he's the only way, but it's a way that's open to everybody, every nationality, every color, rich, poor, sick, healthy, Jew, Gentile, respectable, despicable. Exclusive is the last thing that Jesus is. We, humanity, we were trapped in sin and death, and we longed for God, but the sign says you can't get there from here, and we can't. By ourselves, we can't. Not by our wits, not by our deeds, not by our philosophies, not by our scores of invented religions. We cannot get there from here by ourselves. We're trapped in sin and death like a room that's got no doors or windows, and then God opens a door, provides a way in his grace. He cuts through the misguidedness and the deception. He shows us the truth. He breaks the cycle and the grip of death and offers us life. And it's all free. And it's all love. And it's for all people. And it's Jesus. So Charles Wesley sings, the veil is rent in Christ alone. The living way to heaven is seen. The middle wall is broken down, and all the world may enter in. The loving Heavenly Father, you see, hates to be separated from his children. And so he provided a way for him to be able to come to us and for us to be able to come to him. If you want to get to a physical place, you take a physical road. It should make perfect sense to us, therefore, that if you want to get to a person, you take a person. And if you're a human being who wants to get to God, then you take the person who is both man and God. Jesus is the way to the Father, for he is the way and the truth and the life. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for providing a way, for showing us the way, and for throwing out to us this wide open invitation that is addressed to every one of us, that has no prerequisites, no price of admission, no test to pass, extended in love and grace and asking only for our response, our believing response. We thank you for your Son and all that he is. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God, help us to see clearly both your Son and the world for which he came, the world for which he died. For we understand that it is your will for the world to see him and to know him. And since we do know him, it is our privilege to show him to that world. So help us and empower us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.